Dozens are injured after a stage collapse at a high school in the United States. These stories coming up this hour. Hello, I'm Natalie Allen. Welcome to our viewers in the United States and around the world. You're watching CNN Newsroom. This hour with a remembrance, something happening right now. We have live pictures from Yerevan, Armenia, where a memorial is taking place to honor the Armenians who perished in mass killings during World War I. What a stunning picture that is right there. It began a century ago today, these killings. The anniversary is being marked by a canonization ceremony for the victims and then a concert later in the day. And just coming up in a few minutes, we'll have a retrospective on what happened 100 years ago today from CNN's Arwa Damon. A look back. Other news that we're following, the White House is acknowledging a fatal mistake. A drone strike in Pakistan back in January accidentally killed two hostages held by Al-Qaeda. They are American Warren Weinstein, there on the left in the sweater, and Italian Giovanni Laporto. U.S. President Barack Obama apologized to the men's families.
As president and as commander-in-chief, I take full responsibility for all our counterterrorism operations, including the one that inadvertently took the lives of Warren and Giovanni. I profoundly regret what happened. On behalf of the United States government, I offer our deepest apologies to the families.
CNN's Simon Mohsen has new details on the efforts to free the American captive Warren Weinstein in the time leading up to his tragic death. She joins me now live from Bangkok. And Simon, you had followed his story of his captivity and efforts to get him freed for many years.
Yes, Natalie, and when I spoke to one of the negotiators involved in speaking with Warren Weinstein's captors, he expressed his shock and his grief at hearing this news from the President of the United States, saying, "We were so close to another proof of life from the captors. We really can't believe that we're hearing this." And he told me that the last proof of life came last June in 2014, when Warren Weinstein was allowed a phone call with his wife, Elaine. And that was the last time, as according to him, there was proof of life. They were hoping for more. And he felt that the captors were would be willing to release Warren Weinstein, but the changes kept coming. First, they asked for money. They asked for a hefty ransom. And then they changed that to wanting the release of senior Al-Qaeda figures in exchange for Warren Weinstein. And that's when things became rather complicated. But nevertheless, the lines of communication, he told me, were open one way, mind you. He was unable to contact them. They would always contact him. But great grief for all those involved, as well as, of course, his family, who also expressed their grief, both at the mistake by the U.S. drone strike, the Pakistani government for what they said is not doing enough, and, of course, above all, the captors of both Warren Weinstein and Giovanni Laporto. Natalie?
Yes, I was reading that President Obama's phone call to Mr. Weinstein's wife was one of the most difficult things, reportedly, that he has had to do in his administration. What more are we hearing from Pakistan about this that has happened? Certainly, the American drone warfare taking place in Pakistan is not something that they've liked at all.
You know, Natalie, when we use the word difficult, it's interesting here. Awkward might be another word too, because of course the United States for many years was refusing to acknowledge that it was carrying out drone strikes. Now we have two people, one an American, another an Italian, aid workers killed by accident by a drone strike. And so the United States government and President Obama having to rather embarrassingly not only admit that, but apologize. And activists now pointing out that this is not the first time drone strikes have gone wrong. There have been a number of innocent victims throughout this drone war over the years since 9/11. CNN and myself, I covered exclusively the visit of the UN Special Rapporteur for Human Rights, his visit to Pakistan to investigate innocent victims being killed in drone strikes. And we are now hearing from a lot of activists saying that it's time the US apologizes for others killed in this war too. Natalie?
All right. We thank you, Simon Mostyn, for us out of Bangkok on this story. For a closer look at how this happened, let's bring in former CIA operative Bob Baer. He's currently CNN's intelligence and security analyst. He joins us live from California. Bob, thanks for being with us. This attack of a drone by the CIA was ordered after hundreds of hours of surveillance. You were in the CIA. How could they not know these two hostages were there?
Well, Natalie, the problem is our intelligence in the tribal areas where this strike occurred is abysmal. We can watch it from the air, from drones, from satellites. There's some cell coverage, but it's only a part of the story of what goes in that. There's, you know, the U.S. cannot send up agents up there, operatives. You know, in a strike like this, you should have some sort of ground intelligence video from outside the house. At the end of the day, with these satellites, you can't see into a house. Apparently, these hostages were not walked around at night or even during the day. They couldn't be seen. And, you know, this accident, an accident like this, and it was a terrible accident, is almost inevitable.
Right.
And it's what's called a signature strike. And you find a suspect compound. You look at it. You consider whether the people are Al-Qaeda or not. And then whether you know their names or not, the White House signs off on one of these things, and that's what happened.
Right. I was reading that a drone strike can't be authorized unless there is a near certainty that there will be no civilian casualties. But as you say, if there's not ground intelligence, how is near certainty, how's that figured out?
Well, Natalie, I think it's pretty much this administration and the last administration has trying to portray drone strikes as, you know, the perfect weapon, a substitute for American forces, but clearly it's not. I think this is a horrible setback for the White House. These signature strikes, if we don't even know we're killing Americans, who do we know who we're killing on the ground? And when they do a reappraisal on this, I would imagine that the whole drone campaign is gonna slow way down and possibly even go away. And you have to consider that the war on terror cannot be won from the air. It's a political war as well as a military war.
It certainly has been controversial, so we'll wait and see what comes out of this. Thank you so much, Bob Baer, for joining us. Well, despite what's being feared as the worst migrant tragedy ever in the Mediterranean, illegal crossings have not stopped. The Italian Coast Guard released a video showing the rescue of more than 200 people on Wednesday. For many of these migrants, this treacherous search for a better life begins off the shores of Libya. CNN senior international correspondent Nick Peyton Walsh has an exclusive report from Tripoli. We warn you, though, some of Nick's video in this story is disturbing.
Europe's migrant problem seems small from the Libyan coast. These rare Libyan Navy pictures showing the volume of those they save or stop, and even how this man was pulled to safety directly above his sunken boat. Yet there are also those beyond rescue. 70 killed in this one episode, the bodies often without names or pasts, adding to a toll that's hard to count properly, many fleeing wars that refuse to stop. When asked how to solve this almost unsolvable problem, many European politicians have suggested destroying the boats that smugglers use. But in a coastal country with so many lives dependent upon the sea, where, frankly, would you start? Outside Tripoli, 350 migrants are held here for what must seem like forever. A third here Eritrean. All officials say detained trying to cross to Europe. Yeah. They deny that and just want to go home.
4 months, prison to prison, prison to prison. Now what I need, I want, if they want to deport people, let them deport people. If they don't want to deport people, let them leave.
Do your family know where you are?
No, I don't know my condition now.
No, what do they think has happened to you, do you think?
They think that they die.
Maybe they think something close. I don't know that.
Among them, so many pregnant women, we're told, because women choose to cross like that, hoping their child is born in Europe. This Somali woman's journey to Libya took 7 months. Her baby, Sabrine, born just a week after she was arrested trying to cross. She told us when she got on the boat, she knew she was in trouble, but had no choice but to go on. The prison head admitted there is no system in place to send these people home, or jail them, or let them go. Life for them so hellish, they were willing to risk it to flee, yet instead see it pass them by here, caught between countries who don't want them. Nick Payton-Walsh, CNN, Tripoli.
Can certainly understand their desperation for a better life. For more reporting on this crisis, you can head to CNN.com. There's a first-hand account from one refugee smuggled into Europe, his dangerous journey, and why he says he would do it again. In Baltimore, Maryland, at least two people were taken into custody as protesters upset over the death of Freddie Gray scuffled Thursday evening with police. Gray, a 25-year-old African-American man, died Sunday in police custody. Watch as CNN captured one confrontation earlier from the protest.
And here they just got another man. Well, we're being...
We get more on the latest developments from CNN's Brian Todd. He's there in Baltimore.
No justice! No peace!
Not letting up in their show of anger, determined to stay on the streets and on message, protesters press their demand for justice for Freddie Gray. Tonight, signs of anger and dissent among African-American leaders in Baltimore. Some black leaders critical of Mayor Stephanie Rawlings Blake for not expressing more public outrage over Gray's death.
I think the mayor's trying to be too cautious, to be overly calm. And as I said earlier, if we're calm, something's wrong with our psyche. This is not something for us to be calm about.
The mayor's spokesman says it's her record in this case that counts.
Screaming and yelling isn't going to get the Gray family the answers that they're looking for. Screaming and yelling isn't going to get the police department to continue changing its culture as we've seen that process start under this administration. This is about getting results and getting answers.
African-American leaders are also turning their anger toward Police Commissioner Anthony Batts.
He has been complicit and he has allowed for the culture of police brutality to grow in the city to the height that it has grown.
An investigation by the Baltimore Sun found the city paid out more than $6 million since 2011 to settle lawsuits alleging police misconduct. Batts has been commissioner since 2012. No immediate comment from Batts to the criticism of him. But one police official told us the department's undergone extensive reforms and retraining over the past couple of years. And the head of Baltimore's police union downplayed the lawsuits.
Our officers are exonerated in most of the cases. They're settled out of court because it's cheaper just to give money away and then it's all over with.
Blake and current police officials say that under their watch, lawsuits against the police for police misconduct have gone way down. But the Baltimore Sun reports the city is still paying out many of those lawsuits, spending $255,000 just over the past 2 weeks. Brian Todd, CNN, Baltimore.
In the U.S. state of Indiana, a high school musical performance came to a sudden and violent end. Take a look. Nearly two dozen students were injured when the stage just collapsed during a school performance near Indianapolis. At least one student was critically injured.
Every
everybody was singing, it was the last song, and then you just hear this huge bang, and then all the students disappear. And we just like, was this planned? And then silence, and then everybody just starts screaming.
There was this one girl who had like nails in her leg, and she was getting taken out on a stretcher and stuff. And there was another girl with like a dislocated like leg and something. It was bad.
Reports say the student performers had gathered on the stage for the last song of their concert when the platform collapsed. What a tragedy. You're watching CNN Newsroom. When we come back, it has been silent for almost 50 years, but now this volcano erupts not once, but twice in just 24 hours. We've got amazing video for you coming up. And Armenians, as we mentioned at the very top of this newscast, are calling it a wartime massacre one century ago. When we come back, we'll have more on how they're remembering the deaths of their ancestors.